Hi, I'm Jeff Bradshaw, Threadneck Restorations. This old truck brought to you by ElderlineIron.com, the internet's only auction site dedicated to old cars, trucks, tractors, and related parts. Coming up, got a clutch problem. This is our 1968 GMC, sporting a 671 Detroit, naturally aspirated. 5-speed tranny with a 2-speed rear, tandem 2-speed rear. And the clutch master cylinder is going out on me, so push it down and you hold it there. And if you hold it there long enough, it'll eventually just engage the clutch and away you go. Or if you start letting out on the clutch and you think it's going to come out about here, and instead it comes out about there, and you end up killing the truck and it gets to be a pain. Anyway, gotta change that out. Let's get to it. Now, in case any of you are wondering why I don't use air tools, in this particular instance, it's because by the time I get the air line drug out here to where the truck is, go with the brake line, hydraulic line, clutch line. There it goes. By the time I drag the hose out here and get out all the air tools, I could have had this thing off. It's only one line and two bolts. So, no real particular reason to get the air tools out. Besides, I don't have an air-powered line wrench. I got this truck as a basket case back about 5-6 years ago. Belonged to the fire department, and they were out on a brush fire, and one of the firefighters, who is no longer with us, decided to relocate the truck from its current position, and in doing so failed to remove the failed to disengage park brake. So consequently, the only way to get the truck to move is to rev it as high as it'll go. Start letting go on that clutch. That's what she did several times. So it wreaked havoc with the engine, and they didn't think the old girl was worth putting the money back into. They figured they'd just get another truck since this one was so old and tired. Okay. So, I got the winning bid. Found me another engine. If I had to do it all over again, I'd have just rebuilt the one that was in it. I was really hoping those were welded nuts on the backside, but I guess they're not because they ain't backing off. This one did. I thought they were cage nuts. Felt back in there, it's what they felt like. Well, time for some vice grips. Well, this has one of those square nuts that's welded to the firewall. It's no longer welded to the firewall. And when they do things like that, they don't consider that maybe someday it will become unwelded from the firewall. So they don't really leave any room inside there for you to stick vice grips on it. So I gotta use my little pair that I can. Littlest pair that I can. I can't even see it. I can only feel it. There it is. See if I can find a place to put these. Well, I can see it until I stick my hand in there, and I can't see it anymore. Okay, I broke down and got my light. Now where can I put it? I
happens there.
Off again. It's out.
Yay.
One clutch cylinder. Fog getting out of here. Let's see. Yep.
Boy, look at all that stuff fly out of there. Where'd that snap ring go? Fred's closing for the day. Because don't it figure I got this thing apart right at 5 o'clock. So tomorrow, I'll get an inch and an eighth cup. I'll give you a look at this one. That is not supposed to look like that. And that is not supposed to look like that. So, inch and an eighth. We'll clean out all the crappy crud. Couple of seals, be good to go. All right. Now I gotta find that snap ring. Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but brake fluid is water soluble. When you have all that nasty sediment and stuff inside of your clutch master cylinder, just rinse it out with water. Brake job, you got your drum off, they want to sell you cans of brake clean. You know, you're going to clean off all your brake shoes and stuff before you take everything apart. Just get your garden hose, spray everything down, clean. Well, tomorrow Fred will have my wheel cylinder, master cylinder kit, not my wheel cylinder kit. Bore looks good. No pits, no gouges, no scratches. Get the kit, put it in there tomorrow. Since my rebuild kit won't be here till tomorrow, might as well do some plumbing. This part broke off of here. And that's supposed to go down to there. Like that. But, broke. So, gotta get this out of there. It's stuck up inside the threads. So, what we're gonna do is get the hacksaw, cut a few slots in this. There's an interesting development. I went to stick my camera here so I could do a shot of cutting the slots with the hacksaw. And as I brought my head across the front of this pipe, somebody went bzz, bzz, bzz. I'll get you, my pretty. And your little wasp, too. That with iron. Got a little wire brush. Normally I would not use Teflon tape, on this joint that I'm going to today simply because I can't find my pipe dope. I don't want to take the time to look for it. Now you're only supposed to use about 1.5 wraps on these. I like doing about 23 or so. The reason I'm not gluing this to a piece of pipe first is because this determines where everything's going to fall. Now, if you don't have a pair, I highly recommend the large channel locks. Quite costly. Originally, this was all iron pipe, but somebody didn't drain the tank before they set it outside for the winter. Well, they drained the tank, but there was no drain on this pipe because it always sat inside a heated bay. Didn't have to worry about it. So they drained the tank, but this pipe hung down here below the tank level. It was still full of water, so it promptly split it. Let's see. When I made this new piece, I stuck this valve in here. And let's see. Pipe and mail-in fitting. That right there ought to do.
That there, about halfway through the P.
I'll get a great gab gibby goo. Now here comes the fun part. This is where you gotta put your gabba-gibby-goo on here. Get this thing put together before it sets up, so it's right length. Which is about 5 seconds. Going on a downhill slide, so it's going to want to fall down into here and glue this whole thing together. All tight and ready for the next repair. Okay, it's the next day. Well, we didn't come up with a kit, but rummaging through the drawers at Fred's Oasis of Obsolete Parts, we happened to come up with an 1⅛ cup. And I suspect, because of the condition of everything, the cylinder bore's in real good shape. Everything else is in good shape on this thing, and the rubber cup didn't really look all that bad. Well, it was holding the side of the bore pretty good. So I'm thinking that it was all that silt and slime and stuff down in the bottom of this thing. There's just a bunch of dirt down in there, and it wasn't allowing the cup to seal on the bottom of the bore. Henceforth, it bled down. So what I'm going to do, we'll take this here new 1⅛ cup, and we're going to assemble this thing. And I'm almost bet you it's going to work. Well, where's my boot? I know a lot of you would say that I should bench bleed this about now, but if I do that, it's going to just drip out a whole bunch of fluid sitting up there, so I'm just going to bleed it right on the truck.
Well, now, amazingly enough, that nut stayed right where it's supposed to be. A little tighter on that. Can't focus, but I'm going to see if I can't slide this bolt right in there. Very gingerly, of course. Now, when it comes to bleeding on the truck or on the bench, we're not dealing with a brake master cylinder here. We're dealing with a clutch master cylinder, so I'm not real worried about it. Oh, how amazing. You can't imagine how much time that just saved me, that nut not moving from where it was. Give you a shot of that when I get back on the inside. Well, show you what we got going on here. This is where I got my vice grips up in here. It's just amazing to me that after I pulled that bolt out, that nut stayed right there. Because it's no longer welded to that firewall. Nice tight little spot, huh? Click. My clicker torque wrench. Let's see, where'd my wrench go? It was right here. I know it was. Found it right where I left it. Get all the dirt broke up from it so it's turning smooth. That's at a nice angle. There we go. Thread it in there nicely. Click. Bet you didn't know they made them clicking line wrenches, did you? Now, I don't know if you've noticed before or not, but a lot of times if you leave the lid off of a master cylinder and you push down on the pedal, it shoots a big stream of brake fluid up out of there. And that's because there's a relief port that the back of the piston needs to cover up before it'll generate pressure. And oftentimes you can just barely move the pedal enough to where it keeps forcing air out of that relief port. And that's what we're going to do here. So with our camera precariously perched upon the precipice, I'll show you what I'm going to do. You can hear the bubbles bubbling. You can see the bubbles bubbling. Double camera shot there. So I've pushed the piston down just enough to uncover that port. So once it's done allowing the fluid to gravity feed down in below there and stop pushing the air up, and then we'll use the pedal to do it. You see there, it's pumping air out of it. You See, all we're doing is just taking that top little bit of travel out of that pedal. Oh, it just went and spit out the last bit of air. So now we should shoot a little fountain up, but I don't want to squirt my camera. Okay, get a little more air. Hold it for a second. Yeah, that's squirting. Okay, so if we push in on the clutch, nice and firm. And before, when I let it go, it would only come up part way. And I'd have to reach down with my foot, pull the pedal back, so I can get a full stroke on it again. Nope, it's right up there at the top. All right. Put my master cylinder lid back on. Test drive. Back. What was that?
Hey, no nest there. They probably built a nest back up in there. I'll have to pull that down and run.
Camera! Oh, there's my second camera now! I can see it until I stick my hand in there and I can't see it anymore.
Oh,
now I'm stuck.
Oh, I can't move.